does make a lovely shot.
Right. Okay.
The glass. No, I want to ask you one question.
Okay, it's going to spoil my drink, but okay.
Well, hold on. Let me just double check that I'm in focus and all that sort of stuff is working.
Mm-hmm. Don't start becoming like your father's.
What do you mean? Take,
well, because when I first met him at 17, it took him a half an hour before he could take a normal picture.
Really?
Mm-hmm. 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 Mm-hmm.
Think I'm like my father?
Oh, come on now. Come on. Now. What are you trying? Looking for direct things?
Yes.
Nothing ever is direct. It's circuitous. Everything is circuitous. It goes around very unpredictable ways.
This happy-looking couple is Mike and Minna Block. They're not rich. They're not famous. And while they're not exactly ordinary, they're hardly people you'd think of making a documentary about. Even if you were their son, and even if making documentaries is what you do. Until things took an unexpected turn, I never intended to tell their story. I was just trying to capture them for posterity.
I did what?
Did you take that picture from below?
No.
I'll kill you. You cannot use it. You promised.
Can I open the door?
Too much.
Hello? Mom, this is silly. Now, come on. Open the door.
You destroy trust.
I destroy trust?
You photograph me from below.
I'll photograph you from above. I'm... You can see if I get below your eye level, you can stop talking, okay?
What?
If I get below eye level, you can stop talking, okay? See? I'm up high.
Family dynamics are hard to figure out and even harder to explain. All I know is my mom and I have this deep connection that goes way back.
You were a wild one, but only when you could get away with it. As you know, you were a very, very cautious child. Everything you did that was very difficult was in public. When I was stupid enough to take you in a department store, you would do things like running off and hiding someplace in the racks. You were charming. The only time I ever had anything that worked with you, and it's still kind of like a mixed reaction about whether it's the right thing to do, was to have the leash occasionally. I think, do you remember that?
No.
There was a time when you had a harness. I think we were maybe 2 to 3 years old or whatever. And when I had to go someplace where I knew I risked losing you or you were running off or doing something that I couldn't deal with, I had a little, a leash, I guess, on the harness. And so you couldn't get too far.
You kept me on a leash?
Only occasionally, like twice a year in a department store when I had to go and I had to take you, period.
It's all coming together now. You had me on a leash.
I had you on a leash maybe twice a year when I had to go to a department store, which I still hate to go to. Maybe you're the responsible for that.
My mother and I have always been close. My father is a very different story. Let's just leave it at that for now.
Hey, come on now.
Okay.
He's lighting my fire. He's lighting my fire.
My parents have had a marriage that, in its own modest way, is well worth celebrating. They met in Brooklyn while in college and got engaged shortly after my father returned from World War II.
We corresponded, actually, while he was in basic training. And he came home on leave one time, and he was really quite a gorgeous guy. And he lost a lot of weight, and he was looking particularly nice and lean. It was one of those instances of tremendous physical attraction, you know. And that was kind of like that.
Once married, my parents had the requisite 3 kids, 2 girls and a boy. then found the perfect spot to raise them. A brand new house in the sleepy commuter town of Port Washington, New York. Dad brought home the bacon. Mom stayed home with the kids.
Come here, Bilbo. Give me a hug.
And for over 50 years, they've managed to make it look easy.
Hello, baby.
Marriage is going to be very hard work. Ask any married couple, and they will tell you it's not for kids. It's very, very hard.
I sometimes shoot weddings to support making documentaries. It's very intimate work, and being right in it always reminds me what a vast leap of faith every marriage is.
To marry someone is to say to that person, I have chosen you above all others whom I have met, or who I ever hope to meet.
My desire. Do you ever think about what's going to happen to the people whose weddings you shoot?
The only way I can put it is, I do a lot of projecting of like, you know, is this couple gonna make it or not? There's some couples I know are gonna just be there forever together. They're like so solid. And there are others I go, man, this isn't gonna last a year. What are they getting married for?
When a felon's not engaged in his employment.
My own marriage has lasted 18 years. And my stepson Josh and daughter Lucy are two of the many rewards. But if someone had been taping our wedding, I'm not sure Marjorie and I would have come off as a good match. Law professor with 10-year-old son marries struggling filmmaker, 5 years her junior. Go figure. To me, though, marriage is a marathon, not a sprint. And the measure of success is, can it stand the test of time?
Well, just in general, how does the reality of marriage differ from what people go into marriage think it's going to be?
Oh, it's never the same. Because as far as I know and as far as I've read, you go into marriage pretty much feeling that it's going to be, or thinking, you've had a, quote, role model, which is not necessarily good or bad, but you think that's what marriage is all about. You've seen your parents and how they operate. And it doesn't fit you almost any time.
For over 50 years, my parents were an inseparable unit. Mike and Minna, Mom and Dad.
It's a little discouraging that almost everybody in this thing is dead.
Well, that's what happens. You hang around long enough.
50 years is 50.
You hang around long enough, and that's what happens.
Then, recently, without any warning, it happened to my mom, too. Mom's death was shocking. She came down with pneumonia, and 3 weeks later, she was gone. I can't even begin to comprehend it. But soon, life moves on, as if nothing's changed. My father's living alone for the first time in his life, and we're all concerned for him. My two older sisters live hours from Dad, and New York City's just 45 minutes away, so I try to squeeze in a trip whenever I can. The thing is, my dad and I have never known what to say to each other, and now Mom's not around to fill in the awkward moments. So I bring my camera along to help give us something to talk about.
Okay, we're on?
Yep.
Okay, I want to catch up on some background material.
Okay.
We came in this house at 51, and we have some pictures of the kids at that time. Bangs and all.
Who cut? You or Mom?
Of course I did all the cutting. And they've always complained that my line wasn't nice and straight.
Mm-hmm. I don't know. What was it like to have three kids and be in a house to pay off?
Well, I like activity mixed with a non-constant type of program to be involved with. And fortunately, I fell into that type of program almost all the time. An incident, one for instance.
I can't say I look forward to these visits.
Douglas was always a problem eating.
No matter how old I get, I somehow always feel like a kid around my dad.
Not paying attention to anything the way I thought a model.
Maybe that's why we have such a long history of avoiding each other.
I don't remember spending time with him individually. At all. Honestly, I can't think of any time when I was just me and Dad on purpose. You know, not just because we were left in the house because everybody else went somewhere else, but that we chose to do something together. You did, you know? I think.
I had good times with Dad.
Well, you had alone times with him. You had all the sports stuff going on. And sailing. Sailing was a lot of fun.
But, you know, I have to say, I hated sailing.
Oh, did you?
Oh, God, particularly when we were alone together.
Oh, see, I was never alone. You and Dad went sailing alone?
See the string on the lid I'm playing here?
Yeah, you want to
go. Shows you where the wind is going.
I still hate sailing.
So you're automatically correcting me. You know that's the correct way. You're steering correctly, is what I'm saying.
Oh, good.
What are you going to do now? No.
You need some linen, towels?
Nope.
You sure?
Yep.
You need shaving cream or anything else?
Nope.
Need a hacksaw?
No.
No?
No.
Not gonna cut anything off? Okay.
I know I should take something. If only there was something here that I wanted.
I'm looking what else I can dig out for you, Doug. You're not a fisherman, so I can't give you stuff for lead weights. You're not a motor man, you're not that man.
You don't do any painting, do you?
No.
No painting. God almighty.
Being in Dad's basement always reminds me how little I have in common with my father, the mechanical engineer, and how little we know about each other.
The painting stuff you don't want and all that type of work you don't want. Working tools you don't want. You want just tools to help out around the house. This is going to be for Lucy, a moccasin kit.
So this was your sanctuary, huh?
Yes, this is where I escaped at times to do, and I did a lot of work down here.
Like to work with your hands, eh?
A lot. Okay.
This is the Dad I do know. Lost in his work, silent.
Did you have trouble talking to Dad?
Dad's not a very sharing person about himself. He's not quick to communicate, never has been. He doesn't talk about his childhood. He doesn't talk about his feelings. He doesn't talk about himself.
He was such a 1950s dad. He had a lot of expectations, and he was, you know, he was really rigid. Do you remember he used to whistle for us like we were dogs? And if you didn't come, you know, you'd be in trouble, so.
You did not want Dad to snap, and he didn't snap, but he seemed like he always seemed like he could.
Sitting down at the dinner table, we couldn't just eat dinner. It had to be a competition. We had to do math, we had to do vocabulary. If we argued about a word, somebody would have to run and get the dictionary. There's this book, Cheaper by the Dozen, and it was written by a guy who is an efficiency expert, and he ran his household so that it would be efficient, and I read that and thought of Dad.
Do you think there's, like, something I haven't resolved with him yet?
Of course. But I don't know what it is.
Well, that's not helpful.
Well, but it's just truthful. I mean, I suppose if one goes through psychoanalysis, you know, real psychoanalysis, going 4 times a week for years, maybe you resolve everything with your parents. And you, I mean, one does, I'm not talking about you. But short of that, I think we all go to our graves without having all of our issues with our parents resolved. They're too primal.
There was a point in my life when I thought he knew everything. And when you made that film for Dad's 65th birthday, and you interviewed us, and you asked for a Dad incident or anecdote, and what I said on that film was that I thought he was perfect, and that he knew everything that there was to know. And when I was 8 or 10, I asked him something, and for the first time, he said, "I don't know," and didn't believe him.
I wasn't disillusioned, because it was years before I would believe that that was true. But it is one of my favorite memories.
Special message? Oh.
Besides clean up the backyard. Or...
No. The special message actually is in the birthday card, which I gave. Are we on camera?
Yes.
Okay. Which I gave him yesterday, which said, in essence, would you like to be young again? And the inside says, of course, I wouldn't either. And I think that Mike is growing old very gracefully and very nicely, and I have great hopes for the future.
As us, I just swam my first mile in my life. I never did it again. You know, it's still clear to me like yesterday, Doug. Amazing, right? There's a nice picture of her.
Nobody lives forever. I know that now. My dad's 83, and I'm almost 50. If I ever hope to resolve things between us, this is the time. But just as we're finally starting to make some headway, Dad throws us all a curveball. 3 months after my mother's death, he takes a trip to Florida, then calls to announce he's reconnected with his secretary from 35 years ago. Her name is Carol, but my father's always called her Kitty.
Having declared yourselves in the humanist tradition, you're now husband and wife. And we do have some music.
For some, Dad and Kitty finding each other after all these years is like something out of an old-time Hollywood love story.
I think it's wonderful. I really do. I couldn't be happier for you.
But for me and my sisters, it's a very different kind of story.
How did you feel when Dad called and said that he was living with Kitty?
Shock.
What? What do you mean you're living with her?
I was not happy. For the longest time, all I could think about was, how did Kitty even find out that Mom had died?
You know, I thought it was really good. I thought he was really lucky to have found someone like Kitty. But I felt, this is really bad. Now, this is much too fast.
I thought it was an insult.
To who?
Mom.
This is Kitty and Mike's song. We'll play it right now.
Only
After 54 years of marriage to my mother, Only You strikes me as a particularly odd choice for my father to make. But as best man, it's not a day for personal opinions.
It's really nice to get out from behind the camera and be able to offer this test to my father and Kitty or Carol or whatever her name is. You know, Kitty met my father, I guess it was probably about 35 years ago or so. And, you know, he's mellowed over the years. My sisters and I you know, did our bit to soften him up, and you know, our mother did a lot to soften him up, and I'm sure she would really approve and appreciate Kitty, and probably think you're a little bit crazy. So here's to the lucky groom and the lovely bride. A toast.
Cheers.
I remember being struck with the wedding when they held that kiss for, I believe I counted it to about 9 seconds.
That's nice. Good role model. She's a good role model for Deb.
I think I timed it at 12 seconds. And it was about 11 seconds longer than I remember Dad ever kissing Mom.
I don't remember Dad kissing Mom at all. You know, this is our unemotional, undemonstrative father who all of a sudden is saying I love you all the time. What?
He's the new and improved Dad. He's very happy, I think. That's pretty nice. So, how can you not like that?
Soon after the wedding, there's another surprise. Dad and Kitty have sold the family home and will be moving away to Florida in 2 weeks. My sisters and I have come back to see if there's anything from our past we may want to keep.
This one I knew I'd end up with eventually if they ever sold the house because I made this. So, yeah, it is weird.
This is gonna be number 36.
Okay.
What an ordeal. 50 years of stuff.
You're not kidding. Are you interested in this at all, Doug?
What is it?
That's an inspection light, you know, for slides and anything else that you want to look at. You know, this.
Oh, I see. A big box light.
Yeah.
No. Takes up a lot of space.
I know. Takes up space. Yeah! Wow! How do you like this guy, Doug? Any good?
It's not in good shape.
Not good. Well, it could be mounted up. We'll give it to Janet. She's an artist.
What have you been doing mostly with Mom's stuff?
Her stuff.
You're not throwing anything away that you really
care for.
Family sentimental. Yeah.
I'm not going to throw the kids away. I'm not going to throw lots of things.
Ever since my father called from Florida, he's been focused squarely on the future. And that's great. But I'm still stuck in the past. Why do I suddenly care that Kitty was a guest at my bar mitzvah back in 1966?
You know, I don't quite understand why it matters to me whether, you know, I find out my father and Kitty had something going on way back when. It wouldn't even be all that earth-shattering, you know. I mean, it's like, happens all the time, but, you know, it's just, I don't know whether it's because it's so out of character from my father or because, you know, it's just a parent. You know, expected of your parents, I guess.
I don't know what that is for you either, because I'm projecting my own feelings about fidelity onto that.
And your own feelings are?
You know, you say, it happens all the time. And mine are not to the people, you know, that I'm close to. Or it's not supposed to, anyway.
Little low. Oh. This is called living, see?
We just sort of blend.
It's sex, that's all.
Oh, sex.
All
right.
Sex.
Amen. Anyway, yeah, I guess if we had to depend on sex, we probably wouldn't be here.
He's my son.
Oh, he's your son? Don't tell him any secrets. Oh, God, you're going to take a picture of my rear end going up the stairs? I found it. This is a picture of us when we first knew each other, when we worked together. This was in the 60s. I think that's around 1964 or 65. Aren't we cute? The dark hair, all gone. We worked real good together, and we're still working good together. Whatever it is, we're for each other. We both care for each other, and we look out for each other. It's just something that is. You can't force it. It's something that happens very few times in a lifetime. So I am happy that we're together.
Doug, do you know anybody who can use a display book?
No.
Lucy, maybe?
No.
I guess I agree with Kitty. It is something that happens very few times in a lifetime. But I can't help wondering how many times it's happened for my father, and when exactly it happened with Kitty.
I frankly remember he used to take these trips down to Florida.
I pay a visit to my mother's brother, my Uncle Josh.
It was almost a regular thing. And I used to wonder about the other life that he had. I thought that he had certain an eye for other women. I thought that he was basically very suave looking, and he took care of that mustache. I wrote a song called I Flunk Adultery. I wrote it because I flunked adultery. I never had an affair outside my marriage. I just was lucky that way. It's hard for me to confess the truth that adultery can happen in a telephone booth. Cause to keep my scoreless slate intact, I would never find the room to consummate the act. I flunk adultery cause I can't go all the way. And while I sing the play's a thing, the organ doesn't play. So if the thought of getting caught does so much to upset me, I flunk adultery cause my wife won't let me. Nah. What can I tell you? Of a performer, really.
Clearly, I need some perspective from outside my family. So I arranged a visit with author and therapist Samuel Osherson. He wrote maybe the classic book on father-son relationships. So I figure if anyone can help me sort through my feelings, he's the guy.
Let me describe what's going on for me now. You know, my mom died unexpectedly, and 3 months later, my father calls from Florida to say he's living with his secretary from 35 years ago. They married and then sold the family house. And
what's that like?
Well, certainly stunned us all and left a lot of questions open.
I bet, yeah.
And, you know, this is going on right now.
I mean,
so
do you want to say more?
No, you know, I just throw this out there because, you know, I'm just curious what comes up for you.
What comes up for me is, let's talk about loss. Because I think what you're saying is as much or more about loss than it is about fathers and sons. I mean, there's two things here. It's how your father dealt with the loss, and then how you have to, what your work is, right? And I can't say what your work is, but all I can tell you is, for me, the work was coming to terms with the fact that my mother could die, you know? At one level, when a mother dies, it feels like the whole world gets uprooted. I mean, at least for me, I felt like the world is no longer the way it was. And the trustworthiness of the world. How could this have happened? I wouldn't be, it wouldn't compute. I mean, the world doesn't compute for me anyway with my mom dead, to be honest.
Doug and Colby. We were playing New Year's Eve. And this is the last time I saw Mom. Ah, I forgot that. That's really amazing.
This is garbage.
What the heck is this? Doug, are you sentimental?
A little.
A little? What are you sentimental about?
Mostly family.
Oh, she had a lot of articles.
Yep. Consequences of the relationship of a father and son working together.
Hello?
There's still a lot of Mom's stuff to sort through, and her longtime friend Natasha has come by to help out.
Oh, my heavens, some of this you may want.
I doubt it.
Oh,
You don't need to look at that, believe me.
Yeah.
Believe me.
Oh,
believe
come on, sweetheart. It's nothing.
What do you mean, it's nothing? Feuds and family firms? Nothing.
I came just in time, dear. Weekly food diary.
There you go.
Oh, boy.
Jesus.
There's nothing personal in these.
This has all been edited.
Don't you think we know the difference between garbage and something that's good?
You want the gospel stuff?
Right.
Season's greetings. Joe. Chamber Music Society. Martha's Vineyard. 1964.
Fred and Felix. I can't get a hold of Freddy anymore. Poetry.
Okay,
what
did
you do? Do you ever have a chance to read them?
Yeah. Oh my God. Manuscripts. Oh, this is a lot of writing, dude. You guys have to decide if you want this.
Oh, wow. Oh,
1968 to 70.
I'd totally forgotten that my mother kept a daily diary for many years.
It's about her father.
Yeah. Lee and Marty.
About my
Lee and Ed. Family. Lee and Ed.
About Doug here. Judaism.
I could start a car.
This is all about
this.
Therapy, folks.
I don't know about reading this.
Save it. Mena was seeking all the time something.
Article on herself.
She's always looking to find out who she was and what she was. To understand herself. Oh, wow.
There's really a whole lifetime here.
Digging up all of the stuff that Mom had written was hard because it was stuff that she was passionate about. She wrote on, you know, hotel paper and odd sheets of things. I mean, everywhere. There was just, her writing was everywhere.
There's three boxes filled with her diaries, going back to 1968. Mom's secrets may be right here for the taking, but do I have the right?
I actually never really thought about it much. I knew she kept them, but I didn't really think about how far back they went.
Well, what do you think should be done with them?
We thought burying them with Mom would have been like the best thing to do. But unfortunately, it's too late for that.
She wrote her real feelings, and obviously some of her feelings could have been negative and still have some inclination to read them, though.
I think Mom used them to vent, and she vented a lot. And I think she was angry a lot. And I think she was angry at Dad a lot. I don't think he was the only one, but I think he was probably the biggest target. Jeez, look at that. That's me.
But you don't know, you haven't read them, right?
Did you read her poems?
Yeah, they were in Happy Poems.
They were Mom. They were kind of me. What am I like? Who am I really? You know, all very totally introspective. If you read those poems and you didn't know anything about her, you wouldn't know she was married, you wouldn't know she had a family, you wouldn't know anything about her. You would only know a little bit about the inner workings of her mind.
Do you think she was a good mother?
She was not a warm mother. I think we missed a whole lot of that from both of them. And I knew even as a kid that was missing.
So I think I have everything of mine.
Okay. You ever take a look at the books? Maybe you would want some books. Books downstairs, no?
I don't have room for books.
Okay.
That's why Dad's more recent behavior and attitude has been quite remarkable.
Here's one for you, Doug.
Hey.
Good night.
I think it's very much Kitty's influence on him and the difference in their relationship versus his relationship with Mom. There's a part of me that does want to say how long that difference has existed. Was his relationship with Mom so negative for so long? There's a whole part of me that doesn't really want to know.
I'm with Ellen. Part of me doesn't want to know either. But part of me does.
Talking to Ellen and Karen, I think we all have trouble remembering our early childhood years.
Where?
Here.
Here?
Yeah. Why would that be? What went on that we didn't realize, remember?
Well, there are a couple of things that were going on. One of the things that was going on was that I wasn't happy, particularly, and the marriage wasn't working very well. I had those pictures of me with that hat on, and the picture of an absolutely frozen-faced, you know, suburbanite. It's horrible. I mean, truly horrible. And it was just a whole bunch of stuff that was being programmed and locked in, and it was awful. It was affecting our marriage. It also was affecting everything. The only time I was happy was when we were on vacation. When we went away, something got released. I had no responsibilities for the house. I had very few responsibilities with the kids. I mean, we were sharing it. And I love traveling and I love vacations. And year after year, we go away. And you remember very well the time we went to California. And year after year, we go away and I come back and the car would come up the street and I would start to cry. Because then the whole thing was descending on my head all over again.
You know, I go back and look at interviews I've done with her in the past, and it was just obvious.
That she was...
unhappy, that there were parts of the marriage where she was just very unhappy. She said it right out loud, and it's like I never heard it. But, you know,
it's hard stuff. It's quite a moment in the family, isn't it? I mean, who wants to know these things at some level? Or do you?
Reading Mom's diary confirms everything I'd feared. There's no mistaking it. Her unhappiness and frustration is palpable, and much of it is directed at Dad.
I don't remember her sounding like she was having a lot of fun too often. When we were younger, I know that Mom had to spend a lot of time with us alone, that Dad worked fairly long hours, and she was a traditional 50s housewife, and she had to discipline us or try. I think she was overwhelmed. I think she was frustrated. I know she loved us. You know, I don't worry about that part. But she should have been born later. And not had 3 kids in 4 years.
Mom was a couple of different things. Mom was, first of all, a very social animal, a very suburban lady. She sort of did, you know, the beauty parlor thing every week. And, you know, she did things like the Hadassah, and she went out for lunch with her friends. I don't have a great sense that she shared a whole lot of stuff with us, though, under it all, about herself. But I didn't see that as being unusual. I didn't feel like there was something really wrong.
It's strange to see her not as my mother, but as a woman, a young and frustrated woman who thought about sex, liked sex, wanted more of it. An intellectual city kid, stuck in the suburbs, alone in the house all day, struggling to fill up her time and feel useful. As an outlet, Mom plunged into psychotherapy. In her sessions and at her typewriter, self-reflection consumed her. And what she reflected on most was her marriage.
Was there anything that you wished you'd said to her that you never had a chance to, that you regret?
No, because it was really hard to get her to listen. The only way I could say one last thing to her would be now. Now that she's dead, you know, I could write her a letter or do something like that, but I can't imagine how I could have done that while she was still alive.
You mean now that she's dead, she'll actually listen to you?
As much as she ever did. Oh, God. That's a horrible thing to say. And it's probably not even true, but yeah, it was really hard to get her to listen. Good thing Dad's still alive.
Were you unhappy when I was a kid?
I don't usually go back and review past items to judge them. If I did an action, that's what I did at the time, to the best that I could do.
Any actions you regretted or things you regret? Or
I don't even want to dwell on those things.
I'm just curious to hear from you, you know, what it was like for you.
I know.
You know, I mean, you never talked about it while we were growing up.
We never talked about it.
You never talked about your work. You never talked about family issues or...
Well, working was always a good place for me. I have a lot of good memories from the past. I have a lot of good things from the past. And so they're part of me, those good things. I'd like to follow an old Roman saying called nil nisi bonum. That means speak only good of the past or the dead, and not dwell on the other parts. We put behind us some of the worst parts and leave them there. No use bringing them up all the time.
I'm a part of a generation, maybe like you are, in which we talk about stuff, and my dad was not. Our fathers grew up in the time of the strong, silent male. Men took care of their families by working and earning a living. And they had lived through horrific things.
And so I think there was a focus on work in order to keep away the melancholy spirit.
I loved my work almost all my working career.
Uni struck metal framing. Uni. Just the intellectual pursuit of something on a design concept is very, very satisfactory thing for me.
This goes into here.
I spent many a midnight hour doing the work and filing it away.
According to the diaries, my parents were becoming increasingly isolated from each other's lives. Was it his work or something else that was keeping them apart? Mom wondered too.
Okay. Now, what did Mom think of Kitty? I mean, did she make anything of your relationship at the time?
None at all. She knew she worked for me. We didn't have anything to be concerned about.
No one, though, ever made you question whether your marriage was worth keeping?
I found women more interesting than men. I always enjoyed the company of women.
I really didn't know your mother that well. The only thing I always remembered about her, she was beautiful. And she had a great speaking voice. You know, on the phone, she always came through as so full of life. You know, she was a beautiful woman.
Did she seem in any way frustrated?
Yes. I think that she had certain drives that were not satisfied, but I think she tried to make do.
We were very much molded by what was going on around us. My generation and Minna's, at least I can say for myself, were just blown away by the movies, which I think had a very deep influence on us as far as romance and living happily ever after and having the picket fence and the kids. So we worked on your recipes and you wanted everything to be just nice. And it was only after a while that I think we began to wonder, isn't there something else more to life than keeping the house clean? And that's when houses got dirty. Well, I think the big issue was power and the fact that women had so little to say in what was going on. There was a general feeling, you just don't understand me kind of thing. And then when we went into therapy, you felt completely understood.
Both Natasha and my mom went to the same therapist, Ben, for many years. My mother felt her work with him so completely changed her life, she convinced my father to take it up as well.
Do you see them both going through therapy as sort of like the before and after?
Yes. Well, they really did change, especially Mom. I think for a while there, she got to be the person that she had wanted to be, that she was really liberated.
Oh, brother, that was a very peculiar time in some ways. I was going through my hip mother period, you know, the marijuana bit and all that kind of stuff. God, was that funny.
Jeez, I mean, I was in college and it was break and I was in my room and I was smoking dope with Phil Bernstein, and Mom came up and she said, oh, can I try?
Well, yeah, my first airplane flight. Everybody else had been in a plane except me. And finally, I flew up to Rochester for this parents' weekend, something or other. And the first thing I know, I'm being invited to somebody's suite where they were all smoking pot. I joined them. And I'll never forget this one because they played the 1812 Overture. And, you know, all those myths about how pot was supposed to enhance your sensory perceptions. This was right. But I never heard that thing before or after that sounded so fantastic. At 1812 Overture.
When your parents are smoking marijuana, what are you going to do?
Dad smoked marijuana? He did? When?
I think in his couples group.
Mom became a women's libber. Dad grew his sideburns long. Suddenly, our parents were cool. It was a heady time.
The whole sexual revolution was out there. One couple came over and wanted to do an exchange, and another one was interested in group sex, and I know I had gotten a lot of, quote, offers.
For Mom, the 60s in therapy was a cause for celebration. But while she loved to share her psychological insights with anyone who'd listen, my father was typically low-key about joining a men's group. Even now, I know little about it.
We get together and talk about our problems. At first, we didn't know how to talk about it. But finally, we got around to the point where a guy would say, I have a problem with my wife. I have a problem with my kids. I have a problem at work, whatever. And that would trigger a discussion. This went on for at least 12 years. In the beginning, we weren't even aware of our own feelings. But slowly, when we listened to another person, it evoked certain feelings of empathy or recognition. When another guy was talking, I recognized that he was angry, but he didn't express it. Which taught me over a period of time that I didn't know how to say I was angry. I didn't even recognize that I was angry. And so I learned. I practiced getting angry with my group. And believe it or not, it was a hard thing to learn. But I learned that anger doesn't destroy a person. Anger is okay. That led to a tremendous change in my life. And it actually led to a wonderful living pattern.
With you and Mom?
No, it didn't rub off in that sense. I think our focus shifted off from what we were centered on early in life to something else.
That something else was all too clear. Her therapist. Mom was becoming increasingly obsessed with him.
Did my mother share her feelings about Ben?
Well, she had very strong positive feelings toward Ben.
Well, did she share that she was like madly in love with him?
With her husband?
With Ben.
With Ben. No, not that she was madly in love with him, but everybody falls in love with their therapist, right?
Maybe so, but not everybody makes explicit sexual advances.
I found these. Ben, dear, you were masterly tonight. You put everything in excellent perspective. Goes on a while. However, in stressing your shortcomings, you overlooked a couple of things. First, I wasn't talking about marrying you or living with you. I was talking about an affair. Loving you is just so bittersweet an emotion. I spend so much of my time alone in imaginary conversation with you. Such an important part of my present.
Yeah, for me, the hardest thing, personally, is the intensity of her feeling. You know, she was not one to express intense feelings to us, and never seemed to express anything emotionally or, you know, physically to my father.
Mm-hmm.
So to read how intensely she felt towards Ben was a real shock in a way.
Yeah, well, that's true. She, intense was a good word. There was a deepness of feeling to her that got expressed in her writing. And your father was just so different. I think it was a conscious choice to be with Mike. And any of the excitement or other pieces of life that he did not clue into, that she had her own maybe emotional and spiritual life outside of his.
Memory may be vague, but the diaries are clear. Mom was having an affair, and it wasn't with her therapist either. She doesn't refer to the guy by name, but clearly he's a friend of my father's too. She even writes about a bizarre night out where this friend came along with my parents and me to the local movie theater. While my dad and I had our eyes glued to the screen, inches away, my mom's attention was elsewhere. Some stories are so vivid, they stick in your mind and threaten to obscure other memories. Suddenly, I'm not sure I want to learn anymore. I can't help thinking, when it comes to your parents, maybe ignorance is bliss.
Michael and Kim, you will speak words and exchange rings that make you husband and wife.
In the middle of all this, I have a wedding to shoot, and it's a real relief to be around love in full youthful bloom.
What's that?
It's also refreshing to see a young rabbi with a sense of humor.
Your marriage will grow and change and pass through phases.
I'm not that religious, but I find myself listening to his sermon in a way I usually don't.
Phase forever. But we know that your relationship will modulate in color and brightness and shape. There are going to be days that may seem dark and cold as a crescent moon. And yet we know that a waning cycle comes only to foretell another new moon that will wax again to fullness.
I ask him later if I can pay a visit. I feel I could use some God's eye perspective.
Well, thank you for seeing me. Let me explain a little bit about why I got in touch with you, which is not long ago. My mother died pretty suddenly, and she left behind like 30 years of daily diaries that are what does like the Bible say about like reading personal diaries left behind by parents?
What does your heart say about it?
Well, my heart is confused.
Yeah.
You know, I try and see things from her point of view, and it's just hard to take in. You know, she was very attractive. She was 45 at the time she started writing these, and they were an outgrowth of her therapy during an unhappy spell in the marriage.
Mm.
And they're written to her therapist, who it became clear she fell madly in love with.
Wow. What would I do if it were my own family? I know myself, I'd read them. I know that I'd read them because I would want to know more about my family, which I think can be a way of coming to terms with myself and who I am, and can be used for a holy purpose. Whether or not I would broadcast them to the world would be a different case, but it would have to depend on what I discovered therein.
I discover Mom was living with two very different attitudes about her marriage. Outwardly, energetic and optimistic about how it could be improved. Inwardly, hopeless. And yet she continued to work away, trying to fix it.
We were probably more naive than we thought we were. We saw problems in our own parents' marriage, and we thought we were going to do it right. We were sure we could do it better, and I think we did do it better, but there still were problems.
Was there much divorce back then?
No. Very little divorce.
Why is that?
I mean, that is a very good question. I think it was not done. People didn't know they had a choice. Women especially, I think.
Well, if they didn't then, they sure do now. If you go purely by statistics, more than half the brides and grooms I shoot will call it quits before death does them part. As for me, there are times when it feels like just a given that Marjorie and I will grow old gracefully together. And then there are the other times.
you ask me what's most important to me, I guess I'd talk about how fulfilled I am in my work as a teacher, and in my work as an activist, in my own small way, and in my relationship with my children. I just get so much pleasure out of those aspects of my life.
Who about me?
Well, you know, it depends on the day you'd ask me.
Somehow, we always manage to slog through those really bad days.
Come on, I'm really in a mood for this.
Yeah, no, I'm just testing.
We talk it out, we work it through, and so far, nothing has seemed unfixable.
You know, every marriage is going to have some moments that feel cold and dark. But what's saddest of all is when a relationship that has experienced that kind of a waning or a growing apart can never experience a full state again.
Somewhere along the line, Mom seems to have thrown in the towel on Dad. It was no longer just a temporary bad spell to be fixed. No matter how much or little her affair or Ben really meant, it wasn't her marriage that was her first concern.
I can't.
So if I didn't know any better, you seem to care for my father.
I do.
Why?
Why? You know, that's cute. I like that. He is very, very different from any man I've ever met in my life, and I've met a lot of men in my life. He is very kind, thoughtful, considerate, very, very intelligent, and I just enjoy being with him. We went out to lunch a lot because that's when we really had the chance to talk, and I could cry and tell him all my troubles, and he would listen. He was really a good listener, and he helped me find myself. My husband at that time was putting me down all the time, and I got to thinking I was a nothing. Where he made me feel like I was a good person, so he didn't really talk too much about himself. He was just a good listener. So what more could we ask for in life? When you get older, those things are important.
They're not important when you're younger?
No. No, nobody ever thinks of them when you're younger. You don't think of the quality. I married my first husband for one reason only. He was tall and he was blonde. And I always, as a kid, wanted to marry a tall, blonde man. And that was it. He had no other qualifications. This is what we knew about marriage in those days.
This whole business of why and how people get married and with what expectations, I think it's different now than it was then. And then it was virtually, I think, non-existence, at least as far as I know. You get married at those days because it was expected of you, blah, blah, blah. If a woman didn't get married in my generation, she was dead.
It's not easy to see our parents as struggling spouses instead of nurturing moms and dads. And where a lot of these feelings come up and the discussions begin is at the funeral. And that, and in a way, that's entirely appropriate, because a funeral is a time to honor a person's life and legacy. But sometimes it's sad when there are things that could have been said in life that aren't. Where you began actually was not with your mother, but was with your father. Do you think this can lead you to a kind of closeness with him? I mean,
I'd like to. We have, like, you know, just a few days left, so.
Before he's
going off to Florida, which might as well be another planet.
Right, well, not for Jews.
Do you miss her?
No, I can't say I miss her.
I did the best I could with her and for her. But by the end of it, it was an association together that neither of us wanted to break, but it wasn't a loving association. It was a functioning association.
Look at that. Aren't they cute? Yeah. Did Minna know how to ski?
Mm, he tried a couple of times. Wow. I wouldn't call it skiing. Which one's this?
Over 50 years, you go through many, many stages.
Where did I get that hat? It was before we were married.
He was courting.
Yeah.
We try to hide it as much as we could. But we're like two business partners in the house, see?
Yes. Very nice. I like that.
Divorce came up. Of course, we talked about it.
Is that nice?
But we come from a history of staying with it. And she asked me to stay on. So I did.
It's a mix, Doug. And that mix is a mix of good and bad. I suppose you have it in your marriage, too. Is it good all the time?
No.
No. Okay. I hope for your sake that the mix is has a good proportion on the good side. See?
Much better good than bad, though.
What?
It's much better good than bad.
Much better. That's the good one. Okay.
Are you going to miss it?
Sure, I'll miss it. You know, can't help it. I spent the majority of my life here and family grew up, was raised here. But a lot of my peers are gone. The people I used to have here, I had a big bunch of people. They're not here no more. And people my age around here are very few, and mostly they're going through a quiet part of their life now. They don't want to do much. A lot of people just gave up being more active. A few are, but not many. If we have to be realistic, or if we want to be realistic, we look at the things that are as they are, pragmatic approach. Then adapt to them. We can either adapt by doing nothing or adapt by doing something. I chose to do something about it.
A person may live their life as a pessimist. I'd rather live my life as an optimist.
A few of these old friends of Dad's have come out for a goodbye party at the local temple.
Believing in God makes you an optimist?
I believe there is a God, but I revel in the mystery of it. And I revel
actually, I don't know what that means.
I'm saying goodbye to the area. Dan, did you ever think of moving? Did you ever think of leaving Port Washington?
If I did, I never thought of going to Florida.
Are you thinking about it?
Well, 2 years from now, we'll be ready.
Yeah? Yeah. I went through a terrible time. Minna's death was real agony. I hated living alone.
Oh, hello.
Yes. Nor did I want to get into the dating game with people around here.
No, we're driving down.
There were women in the temple. They were calling me almost every night.
Hello, Zora.
Oh, would you like to come over some bridge? Oh, we're getting together to have a little party. Oh, this, oh, that.
Oh, Mimi.
Have you been?
I've been fine, working like a horse.
Well, you're selling your
packing,
house.
Packing, getting ready.
You sell your house?
Unbelievable.
Did you sell your house?
I have a retainer on it. They put down some money to start it, waiting for the contract to come up.
Champagne, what would you like?
The house doesn't determine it for me. I'm ready to move on.
What do you think there is to do? It won't come to you. You got to start it yourself. You got to start it yourself.
I didn't know what you're talking about.
With Kitty, we're both active. We both care for each other. We're looking out for each other. We share things together. A lot of sharing going on. And I find the relationship an excellent one for me.
Stay well.
I'll stay well. You give me the guarantee, I'll give you the guarantee.
That's what we need. I'll go for that.
Take care.
Okay.
Okay?
Yes.
So there's a couple of these things left over.
Is there just one person perfect for you? No. It's not a matter of finding a perfect compliment. I think it's a matter of making accommodations so that it works out for both of you.
Mama.
You know, people have two personas when they are with their husband and when they are out in public. Minna always had a certain guard up. No one knows what goes on behind the closed doors. So.
Well, let me ask you this. Do you think my mother would have wanted me to know what was in her diaries?
Oh, my God. That is the best question. Oh, God. Yes. I would have to say yes. In a way, I think that's what Minna was yearning for, to be known in some deeper sense, and that you could know it and still love her. It took all that writing and all that living and all that therapy for her to break it down for herself. And this goes a long way to a resolution in some way. Yeah, if Minna was sitting here right now, she would be delighted. What a relief for someone to really know us.
Regard this, our lives or our marriage, as a finished product. We never have, and it takes working on it. Takes working on it, you know, all of your married life, I guess. And anyway, it's an adventure. It really is, and that's the part that I like, because nothing is very predictable.
Every time I feel I have a handle on my mother, she pulls out another surprise. Just when it appears she'd given up on my father, I find many expressions of real appreciation for him and the marriage. Maybe that's why the affair didn't amount to much, and she eventually cut it off. While things with Ben never went where she wanted, she continued to obsess over him for many years. And then I come across an entry all about Dad and Kitty. Long after she stopped working for my father, Mom and Dad ran into her one night. It sounded pretty uneventful, and yet Mom awoke in the middle of the night and wrote this down. Mike was very close to Kitty for a couple of years. Whether sex was part of it or not, and I'm still not sure, is really almost irrelevant. Somehow, sweet, pliable Kitty seems to represent the kind of woman Mike should have married if he'd known what he wanted. Instead, he chose me. And I've been too much for him all along.
I don't think I ever really had a realistic idea of what marriage was about. You'd walk into it, you say, look, I care about this guy, I love him, blah, blah, blah. Basically, when I'm not sore at him about something or other, I'm usually very, very grateful, because he's a hell of a lot better than almost any of the men in our generation that I know.
The best compliment I ever got from your mother was, in many ways, you're okay. You're much better than most men I know.
Yeah, I basically love you.
Good.
Not that you don't.
That was the highest compliment I ever got.
I love him comparatively. You want to take the phone, please, Dad?
Yeah, I'll take it.
Earlier in life, I'd have died for it.
Hello, Eleanor.
Absolutely.
Later in life, it meant nothing.
It turned out to be a happy occasion.
But
She loved me as much as she could love anybody, I suppose. She had fantasy love in her head for a long time about a lot of men she admired. There are certain authors she admired, certain people in the political field she admired. I know she idolized Ben.
Ben, her therapist?
Ben was a therapist. I thought she'd have loved to have an affair with him. It never went to fruition. It was fantasy stuff. But what real love meant, I don't think she understood it. I just feel very sorry that there weren't more happy moments for her.
What are you thinking about, sweetheart?
Everything. Okay. So all the stuff up here goes to people that we take care of along here.
We have to fold that up.
Right.
Okay, now I have, here, right here you put it.
Okay.
Give these numbers. Where's my sheet?
Oh, you missed the house?
Sure, I'll miss the house. But I'll miss it as a wonderful chapter for myself. Nobody gave us lessons how to be parents.
You can be famous, gentlemen.
We don't get lessons in how to have a loving relationship.
That's it.
When we learned a lot too late. With practically no shrubs or trees. But I don't think there's any one dominant memory that comes through. Things were growing up around me, the family's growing up, the plants and shrubs and trees were growing up. It's just that it was a wonderful spot. It was like a wonderland for me. Things that didn't work out was my difficult time with Minnick. And so the house was a collection of many, many things.
So one other thing I'm curious about, again, when I was going through those photos. When I was going through the photo collection.
Yeah.
And particularly your photos from the Army days.
Right.
Noticed a lot of shots of you with very pretty women.
Well, sure.
But it got me wondering, given that, the marriage was, had its unhappy times, to say the least, were there other women that you fell for, that you, had strong feelings for? Did you ever fall in love and just not act on it, or?
Wow. Yes, I had a lot of pictures, lots and lots of pictures of girls. Very, very nice girls. But that was part of it.
Well, I'm talking more during the marriage.
During the marriage? I can't remember taking many pictures, but...
I'm not talking about pictures, I'm just talking about getting,
involved with women?
Men do it even when they're happily married.
Right. We get involved.
I never did.
I had plenty of opportunity, just never did. That's all.
So, there it is. I've asked the question and gotten an answer. No secret 35-year affair with Kitty. No dramatic sacrifice for the sake of the family. Just a very difficult marriage that my parents endured in very different ways, with a belated happy ending for my father. Nothing I've learned about my mother will change my love for her. We have a connection that goes way back and remains to this day. But I've also come to realize that, in a strange way, all of this has helped me to form a new connection.
Yeah, I have one last question for you.
Yeah.
Is there anything that you've ever wanted to ask me that you haven't asked me before?
Well, ever? Well, during the other period, I think I'd be talking of the current period now. Are you happy with your life?
Well, maybe you should be shooting.
How do I do it? How do I focus?
It's focused, I think.
Yeah.
What was the question?
Are you happy with your life?
It's a hard question. That's a really hard question.
Let's pin it down a little sharper then.
Yeah.
Okay. What am I saying?
Mm-hmm.
How about your personal life?
Yeah. I'm happy. I feel lucky.
Yeah.
I feel lucky that I met a woman who's, who is such a good match for me in so many ways.
Right.
You know, who's so honest. And who cares for me so much.
Good.
And is loving and who I can share things with, be intimate with, and I'm lucky.
Okay.
I'm getting to happy.
Okay. Are we finished?
We're done.
Okay. I've been very fortunate, Doc, to have you as a son. See, you really did very, very well.
Thanks.
And when I look at my families, boy, I can't believe it. I've been blessed with a good family. And if you're having a somewhat happy life, forget everything else as far as I'm concerned. You got something you can grab and hang on to, and that's very, very good. You can't beat it. It's a great company. It kept me alive, say. And it can be extraordinarily good for you, too. But you've got to enjoy it. Okay. Do you know what time it is?
It's time to go.
All right, you did the thermostat. Bagels, thermos, apples, towels, and a dryer, cooler.
All right, that's all locked up. Okay, that's locked. This is empty right now. Okay. You want this piece?
Nope.
You want this lovely piece of art?
Nope.
How about a tux?
Nope.
No?
Nope.
I'm leaving tux here. Are you reading anything these days?
Nope.
Space by Michener?
Nope.
Okay. Okay. Okay, off. Okay, goodbye, house. Okay.
As I stand in the dark in the middle of the street, my mind drifts back to a past summer day. My parents are celebrating an anniversary, and the entire family is gathered in the backyard.
Hey, why did they put garbage in the ice?
And I'm capturing it for posterity.
Yes, dear.
Happy anniversary.
Thank you, dear. Aren't you glad we got married?